Star Trek Discovery is back on Netflix with Michael Burnham and the crew flung into the far future after the all-life, everywhere-saving events of Series 2. The current series of Discovery sees some new additions to the cast. As announced in the build-up to the show's return, Star Trek's first non-binary and transgender characters will be introduced during Season 3. While this is a first for Star Trek, the show has had a history of diversity and progressiveness that goes all the way back to the original series and its creator, Gene Roddenberry. It has shown cooperation across the lines of contemporary political division and imagined a future where humanity has overcome racism and where positions of the highest authority are open to women as well as men.
Mr. Paris, set a course for home.
More recently, through Discovery, Star Trek has given substantial visibility to same-sex relationships for the first time.
Ow! Are you punishing me?
Yes. And I love you.
Let's look at Star Trek's history of inclusivity.
To boldly go where no man has gone before.
Star Trek was first broadcast in September 1966, a product and a reflection of a time of significant political and social upheaval. The Cold War, Vietnam, civil rights, the countercultural revolution, the race to land on the moon. This was a time of division, tension, but also of hope. Star Trek was an optimistic vision of the future created by Gene Roddenberry, a World War II veteran and former police officer turned television writer and producer. While countless others have made key creative contributions to Star Trek over the years, Roddenberry was the driving force behind the original conception of the show and responsible for its core progressive philosophy. Later, Roddenberry would articulate this philosophy at length on a record called Inside Star Trek.
If you read science fiction, the more you read it, the more you realize that you and the universe are part of the same thing. Science still knows practically nothing about the real nature of matter, energy, dimension, or time, and even less about those remarkable things called life and thought. But whatever the meaning and purpose of this universe, you are a legitimate part of it.
At the time, though, Roddenberry spoke through actions rather than words. In his first attempt to get Star Trek made, a rejected pilot from 1964, the Enterprise's second in command was to be a woman known as Number One.
Sorry, Number One. A little information on this planet, we'll have to leave the ship's most experienced officer here covering us.
Of course, sir.
Leonard Nimoy, who became famous as Star Trek's half-human, half-Vulcan science officer, Mr. Spock, was one of the few members of that pilot's cast to survive the development process. The presence of Spock enabled the show to explore the subject of racism while presenting a vision of a future in which it was no longer an issue between humans themselves.
Keep your Vulcan hands off me! Just keep away! Your feelings might be hurt! You green-blooded half-breed!
And Spock would go on to be embraced by a range of Star Trek viewers from all kinds of backgrounds because of the character's internal conflict. The dynamic interplay of his logical Vulcan and emotional human sides.
He was the embodiment of the outsider, like the immigrants who surrounded me in Boston in my early years. How do you find your way as the alien in a foreign culture?
While science fiction in general often offers a haven for those who feel marginalized, Spock gave viewers a specific point of identification and a vision of inclusion.
You know, as someone who was from two cultures, you know, Iranian father, an American mother, I saw in Spock, you know, that same conflict, I guess, of which one am I? Am I both? Is there a happy medium of the two?
Bonus fact. As his Jewish background was clearly important to Leonard Nimoy's understanding of Spock, it's worth pointing out that the Vulcan salute, which Nimoy invented, is based on symbols he saw during prayers at synagogue as a child.
I found out later this is the shape of the letter shin in the Hebrew alphabet. The letter shin is the first letter in the word Shaddai, the name of God.
Star Trek's diversity wasn't just fictional. While the inclusion of Spock spoke to the show's vision of cosmic unity, its diverse cast of human characters offered more immediate real-world representation, most notably Nichelle Nichols and George Takei. In the aftermath of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941, Gene Roddenberry enlisted in the United States Air Corps. while a 5-year-old George Takei and his family were sent to an internment camp for Japanese Americans. Just 2 decades after the war had ended and his family was released, Takei's prominent role on the bridge of the Enterprise as Lieutenant Sulu was designed to be a sign of humanity's potential unity. In fact, in Roddenberry's utopian vision of the future, Sulu was intended to represent all of Asia, which explains his name.
So he was looking at the map of Asia, and he noticed that off to the side of the South China Sea was the Sulu Sea. And he thought, aha, the waters of a sea touch all shores. And so that's how he came up with Sulu.
Nichelle Nichols, meanwhile, played Lieutenant Uhura, the communications officer on the Enterprise. While Nichols' work is now considered a landmark in entertainment history, the actor almost left the show after the first season, but her mind was changed after a conversation with civil rights leader, and it turns out big Star Trek fan, Martin Luther King Jr.
All the smile came off his face and he said, "You can't do that." He said, "Don't you understand that for the first time, we are seen as we should be seen? You don't have a black role. You have an equal role."
Without Dr. King's intervention, Uhura would never have shared her groundbreaking on-screen kiss with Captain Kirk in Series 3. And more importantly, Nichols' performance as a skilled, authoritative member of the crew might not have reached the many people it went on to inspire. People like Whoopi Goldberg, who went on to appear herself in Star Trek: The Next Generation.
This was a huge part of my life because as a kid who loved science fiction, it wasn't until Lieutenant Uhura did I realize that I was in the future.
When Star Trek returned for a second season in 1967, still at the height of the Cold War, Walter Koenig was added as Russian ensign Pavel Chekhov.
Navigation, Chekhov here.
The character had originally been conceived as a younger British member of the crew who, in the wake of Davy Jones' popularity with the monkeys, might draw a teenage audience. But Roddenberry instead chose to make him Russian, partly to acknowledge the fact that the Soviet Union had beaten the United States into space. This was 2 years before the US landed on the moon. And partly in order to depict a future in which even our most fundamental contemporary political disputes have been overcome. Koenig based Chekhov's Russian accent on that of his own immigrant father.
"Our phasers won't reach it, sir."
As Star Trek moved past the original series and into the future, it continued to portray a progressive version of the future, with the feature films exploring collectivism,
"The needs of the many outweigh
the needs of the few,"
environmentalism,
"To hunt a species to extinction is not logical,"
and the possibility of a universe beyond war.
"People can be very frightened of change."
"You've restored my father's faith."
"And you've restored my son's."
And when new versions of Star Trek arrived on television, they continued the show's tradition of diversity. While The Next Generation matched the original series in having senior women and people of color getting on with the business of being capable in space, Deep Space Nine and Voyager went a little further and put them in charge. Avery Brooks played Deep Space Nine's commander Ben Sisko, a rare black lead in 90s television, and Catherine Mulgrew became the first female captain to spearhead a series at the helm of Voyager.
"Engage."
With a proud tradition of inclusion, in more recent years, Star Trek has attracted some criticism. Star Trek Enterprise seemed relatively conventional after the adventures of Sisko and Janeway, and there were growing calls for Star Trek to address its lack of LGBT plus characters. A first step towards this came in 2016, when the latest feature film, Star Trek Beyond, showed John Cho Sulu reunited with his husband and daughter when the Enterprise docked at Starbase Yorktown. This was followed by a more substantial and visible gay relationship with the arrival of Star Trek Discovery in 2017. The marriage between science officer Paul Stamets and medical officer Dr. Hugh Colbert plays a central role throughout Discovery. There's also space in one of the standout scenes from Series 2 for engineer Jet Reno to tell Colbert about her wife.
"My wife is Soyuzian. She went totally bananas during the planning."
"Believe me, I understand micromanagement."
Indeed, from the outset, Discovery seemed committed to reinvigorating Star Trek's history of inclusion, with a starring role for Sonequa Martin-Green at the head of the most diverse cast yet to appear on a Star Trek show. and that cast is about to get even more diverse.
If you want any more details, then I need to know who I'm talking to, because there's also more to you than you're letting on.
Ian Alexander, who previously appeared as Buck in the OA and Lev in The Last of Us Part 2, will play Star Trek's first trans character, Gray, who's working towards his lifelong dream of being a Trill host. And there will also be non-binary representation in Star Trek for the first time with the arrival of Adira, played by Blue Del Barrio, who finds a new home on board Discovery and forms an unexpected bond with Stamets and Culber.
That's what someone who lives in a museum would say. You live in a museum.
Gene Roddenberry passed away in 1991. But years after his death, Star Trek remains true to the course he and his collaborators set with the original series.
He was determined he was going to have an astronaut corps that represented all humankind.
As Discovery's co-showrunner Michelle Paradise says, Star Trek has always made a mission of giving visibility to underrepresented communities because it believes in showing people that a future without division on the basis of race, gender, gender identity, or sexual orientation is entirely within our reach. New episodes of Star Trek Discovery Series 3 are currently airing weekly on Netflix in the UK and Ireland. Subscribe to the channel for more videos like this one.